Hi, I'm John Helfen, Technical Product Manager for Tinkercad, and welcome to the CTE Makeover Challenge. Today, what I wanted to do is provide a quick overview of a few Autodesk products that can help you plan it and make it. The products we'll be covering are Tinkercad, Autodesk 123D Design, and Autodesk Fusion. Tinkercad's a web-based product that's an entry-level CAD system. You start with very basic prismatic shapes. You can scale and size those components, but you can't draw your own. The purpose of Tinkercad is to introduce 3D design to those who may have never tried. Once they're ready, you can step up to 123D design that allows you to start drawing your own shapes and introduces features that you'll see in products like Fusion. When you're ready, you're able to move to Autodesk Fusion 360. At each level along this path, you'll find that the products do add more capabilities and do require a bit more experience. But by starting through Tinkercad and working your way up, the process goes quite smoothly. Let's look at Tinkercad real briefly. As I mentioned, you start with basic prismatic shapes. You can use the on-screen heads-up display to size and scale, change colors, and even make negative spaces. In the end, you use these shapes to combine and group together to make more complex designs. Of course, these can all be downloaded for 3D printing. Let's look at how to build this part in Tinkercad. Within Tinkercad, you can use the geometric shape panel to select prismatic shapes to begin your design. Once on the work plane, you can use tools like align and group to position and adjust your model to fit your needs. Here I've aligned the two shapes so that they're perfectly centered on each other, and now I can use my arrow key to move the cylinder off to the side of the block. With the heads-up display, you can simply click and drag in order to adjust the size of your model. I know I'm going to use this shape one more time, so I'm going to just copy and paste it so I have a duplicate. I can group those shapes together and make them a negative space so that when this shape is grouped with other shapes, it will remove material rather than add material. After making the adjustments, we can then return to our original model and reduce the height of the platform to 10 millimeters. We'll make a copy of the additional cylinder so that we can use that to cut a hole through the orange cylinder on the screen that you see. We're going to scale that down to 15 millimeters and then increase its height to 20 millimeters so that we can align it with the cylinder. By selecting the heads-up display options on the align tool, you can position the cylinder in the center of the previous cylinder. We'll do a similar action here and align the cutout so that we can make a notch in this platform. With all the shapes positioned, we can simply select them and group, and you'll see that Tinkercad removes the material and creates the more complex design. Next, we'll look at 123D design. As I mentioned, 123D design allows you to draw your own shapes. You can still use the same technology and primitives that you saw in Tinkercad, but you now have the addition of being able to sketch your own shapes, add things like fillets, create shapes like lofts or sweeps, but in a simplified interface without all of the constraint systems and motion and rendering that you might find in Fusion. If we look at 123D design, here you can see we're going to build that same shape, but rather than using primitives, we're going to start by drawing 2D shapes that can then become 3D geometry. In the end, you can add things like fillets and chamfers and other mechanical features. You can also change material types to make your designs look a little more realistic. Let's take a minute to look at how this can be done in 123D design. Within 123D design, you still have primitive shapes just like you did in Tinkercad. Combined with the merge and subtract tool, you could create the part in the exact same way we did in Tinkercad. However, we can now sketch our own shapes. Here you can see I'm sketching a 2D circle at 20 millimeters in diameter, and I can continue by sketching the rectangle that'll make the platform off to the right. I'll go ahead and look at it from the top view to make it a little bit easier for me to see the grid. And I can use the grid to position this and size this to the exact dimensions I need. Once I have the basic shape created in 2D, I can select the profiles that I want to extrude to create a 3D model. Here we'll extrude to 20 millimeters, and then we can move on to extruding the platform. We'll go ahead and select that profile and extrude it to a dimension of 10 millimeters. You can also turn off the sketches so that they don't clutter the display when you're finished with them. We'll repeat that process one more time and sketch a circle on top of the first cylinder we created. We'll set it to 15 millimeters in diameter, and again, we can use the extrude command to remove material. By dragging our arrow down, you can see the red preview shows what's going to be removed. Once again, we can hide that sketch because we're finished with it, and we can continue on to create the notch in the platform. We'll go ahead and look at that from the top view and use the grid underneath to position the circle and size it to exactly 10 millimeters in diameter. We'll repeat that step one more time and create the rectangle that we need to finish the slot. Again, the grid is going to allow you to position things exactly. I'm going to select all the profiles, repeat that process one more time with the extrude command, and cut the slot from the larger part. We can turn off our sketches, and now we can look at some additional features. Within 123D Design, you have the ability to add mechanical features such as a chamfer or a fillet. Here we'll chamfer the top edge of this part, so it might mate with another part more easily. If we rotate to the other side, we can use the heads-up display to select an edge, and again, this time, we'll add a fillet rather than a chamfer. With our part complete, we can now use the material option to change the color and transparency of this part to give it a more realistic look. For example, we could scan through and we could select clear glass. And now you can see that the part is transparent. If we return to the material dialog box, we could select a different material, in this case, for example, brushed metal. And now you can see there's a little more reflection on the part, making it look a little more realistic. Next, we'll look at Fusion 360. Within Fusion 360, you have the ability to see motion, you have the ability to add sketch constraints that build intelligence into the sketch design. Here you can see I'm creating a sketch and adding a tangent constraint to make the line from the rectangle tangent to the circle. This intelligence allows you to go back in time and change your design and have the model update. This is a history-based modeling system, but it also includes direct modeling similar to 123D Design and Tinkercad. With Fusion, you can step up to photorealistic rendering. You can add decals to your models, you can adjust materials, and you can get images that look photorealistic. Finally, within Fusion, you can actually begin to make those parts. Not only can you download or export for 3D printing, but within Fusion, you have the ability to define tool paths that would allow you to take that G code that's created from those tool paths to a CNC machine, and that's all done within the Fusion 360 product. Let's take a moment to look at how you can do this in Autodesk Fusion 360. Within Fusion, you have a lot of the same capabilities that you had in 123D Design, but we're going to add the ability to add dimensions and constraints to build intelligence into these sketches so that as the part changes, the model will update appropriately. Fusion's a history-based modeler with direct modeling capabilities as well. This allows me to start creating geometry and adding intelligence into the sketch. In this case, I drew the rectangle a little large so we can add a tangent constraint so that that line always remains tangent to the circle. What this means is, if I go back and make a change, that line will always remain tangent. If the diameter increases, the width of the platform would also increase. Now that we have our shape, we can select the profiles just like we did in 123D Design. But here, we can always go back and make changes because of the history. We can go back and edit that feature and increase its height, and you can see the model updates. From the browser, we can turn on the sketches individually in order to add the platform. Here, we'll set it to 10 millimeters and turn that sketch back off. Now, rather than drawing another circle, we can actually create a hole feature. This allows us to quickly place and size a hole without having to actually sketch it. We can set the extents to through all so that if this model were to change in height, we would ensure that the hole makes it all the way through the part. You'll also notice that we're using a right-click marking menu. This allows us to quickly access some of the features that you need while sketching without having to return to the menu bar for every action. As I start to sketch this line, I'm going to click and drag on the circle, and you can see that some intelligence is automatically built into the sketch. In this case, tangent and perpendicularity have been added to this sketch so that this slot stays positioned and oriented properly if the model were to change. We'll set this extrusion to cut through all, select OK, and you can see we're almost finished with this part. The last step is to add our chamfer and our fillets. We'll select the edge, use the right-click menu to select chamfer. We can place that. Now we can return and use press-pull in order to add our fillets. At any point, we can use the history in order to return to our sketches and change their dimensions. By updating those, you can see that the model is updated accordingly. Here I selected the face to locate the slot position, and now I'm going to go back and add a dimension to this sketch that wasn't created originally. I can enter a value of 12, check the value, look what it does to the design, and then make any additional adjustments as needed. Again, because the history is there, you can always return and make corrections as needed. We'll go ahead and make a couple edits just so you can see it again and put everything back into its position. Now we're going to look at how we can use the rendering system in Fusion 360 to add photorealistic renderings of our model so that we could show others what we've been building. Here I'm going to go ahead and add a decal to the cylindrical face here. I'm going to select the Autodesk logo, and you can see I get a heads-up display that allows me to rotate, move, and scale the decal within its position on the face on the model. A little tweaking and I get it just the way I want. And now I have my decal placed. I can right-click and select Appearance in order to add materials to this to make it even more realistic. I'm going to scroll down into the Paint section and drag and drop a blue paint color on. And then we'll turn on ray tracing rendering. This will allow the system to calculate how light is bouncing around the scene and create a photorealistic render. You can see, as we sit and wait, the image gets refined more and more over time. I'm going to go back and change this to green and let it dial in a bit so you can see how clearly the decal and the reflection show up in this environment. The longer you wait, the more crisp the image will become over time. Now let's take a look at the CAM system within Inventor. This allows us to take the part we just designed and create tool paths that would be required to manufacture this on a CNC machine. Here I'm going and selecting the origin, and then I'm going to just start with something very basic, an adaptive 3D clearing. I can select the tool I need. In this case, I'm going to select a flat end mill. And I'll scroll through the list and select the quarter inch flat end mill. You can see as I select it, it's updated in the preview so that you can get the exact tool that you need. Once the tool is set, you can simply select OK and allow the system to calculate the adaptive clearing. On the screen, you can see the system automatically building the tool paths that are going to be needed in order to create this part. If we zoom out a bit, we can actually simulate what this is going to look like to make sure it would work on our CNC machine. By hitting play, the system actually runs through the actions that the CNC machine will take so that you make sure nothing's banging into things, the material's being removed properly, and that everything is ready before you actually start cutting parts on your machine. Finally, it's important to remind you that all three of these products have the ability to 3D print. And Fusion has the ability to do both 3D printing and create tool paths for CNC.